A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, I want my share of your estate now before you die. So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land, and there he wasted all his money in wild living. Not a very good son. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land. He began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him. Has anyone ever been that hungry before where you're like, I will eat anything right now, even pig slop? You got to be pretty hungry to get to that point. But no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, at home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, Father, I've sinned against both heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant. So he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, Father, I've sinned against both heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son. But his father said to the servants, quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet. And to kill the calf we have been fattening, we must celebrate with a feast. For this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found. So the party began. Amen. That's a good word. It's a good word. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God, and what a good word it is indeed. So, I want to launch us into where we're going to be for the next few weeks. We're looking at this new series called Basic Training, and if you got the gist of the idea from the video, like, you think of a soldier and how fit they are for duty and combat, and like how they're ready to just withstand anything. But a soldier isn't born a soldier. A soldier becomes a soldier through a long, rigorous amount of training. They go through hours and hours, days and weeks of intense physical basic training that prepares them for the battles that they're going to have to face. I think of an athlete. Some of the greatest athletes in the world are these incredible, they do superhuman feats of strength. I still, as a Seahawks fan, I will never forget the Tyler Lockett catch in the back corner of the end zone that Next Gen Stats says there was like a 0.005% chance of him catching, and yet he just, he wrenches it in, he gets his body in just the right place. Tyler Lockett was not born able to do that. He came to that point through hours and hours and days and days and years of intense physical training, lifting weights, running, practicing, catching a football over and over and over, preparing himself for the moment when he had to do it, when it really counts. You and I have a huge calling on our lives. There's something that God wants to do with you. There are big battles that you're going to face in your life. There are big obstacles that you're going to run up against. There are opportunities that are going to present themselves to you. But if you have not gone through basic training, you will not be ready for the battles that you need to fight. You will not be ready for the opportunities that God is going to put in front of you. You're going to have doors that God's going to give you, a door of opportunity, and you're not going to be able to go through that door because you're not ready for it. In fact, and I believe this, that there are times when the Lord holds back blessings from our lives. The Lord holds back good things that he has planned for us. He has stored up for us, but he holds them back because we're not ready for them. If he gave us that blessing now, it would crush us, it would break us, it would destroy us. We're not ready. We need to go through some more basic training. And so the goal of this series is to take us through some of the basics, the fundamentals that are the foundations for success. The fundamental basic training that's going to prepare us for the life that God's called us to live. I believe that God has bigger things for us than to simply sit and listen to sermons every week and attend church every once in a while. I believe that when you grow up, God has a bigger plan for you than to simply go off and work some job somewhere and every once in a while pray and thank God for the blessings in your life and attend church, maybe super regularly, maybe when it's convenient for you. There are bigger things for you than just church attendance in your life. God wants to He wants to use you for powerful things. He wants to use you to grow and expand his kingdom. And that's not just true for the people in here who feel that I'm called to be a pastor. And I know there's some of you in here who are like, yeah, that's me. I'm called to a life of ministry, and that's awesome. That's good. But every single person in this room is called to a life of full-time ministry. Whether it's on the stage behind a microphone, or whether it's like the rest of our youth leaders in this room who never step foot on a stage, never have a mic in their hands, and yet they do the work of ministry day in and day out in their jobs, in the relationships they have, and the people they interact with. They are sharing the news of Jesus. They are spreading the light of the gospel. They are living out the story of God in their lives, and this is what God has for you. Are you ready for it? And the answer for many of us in this room is no, we're not. Honestly. I say this not to offend you, not to upset you, but to challenge you to say, are you really ready? If you really, like we say all the time, Lord, I want an opportunity to share Jesus with my friend. Well, are you ready for that? Lord, I want an opportunity to just, God, use me. Are you ready for God to use you? Probably not. Have you laid the foundations? Have you gone through the fundamentals? Are you ready for the big game? Let's lay the foundations. Let's go through basic training together. Let's get ready for the big things that God has for us. Over the next few weeks, we're just going to look at fundamental aspects of what it means to be a Christian. Whether that's what we believe, what we do, how we live our lives, how we speak. We're just going to go super, super basic. And you may think, like, man, I've been a Christian for a long time. I've got it. I know that I should pray. I know that I should read my Bible. I know the gospel. I'll see you at camp because I'm good. No, you don't understand. You don't understand. When Tyler Lockett goes out to catch a football, when a soldier is on the field of battle, he's not thinking, oh, good, this is finally the real work. Tyler Lockett is thinking, okay, like, all the fundamentals that I don't know the football fundamentals. This analogy is going to break down really fast because I don't know the points. They go through, I'll go like the music side, right? As a musician, when I play, I'm not just like, okay, here's what I'm going to play. I'm thinking, no, G chord, C chord, D chord. I'm like, I'm thinking about it. Like, it's those basics that build me up. I'm not just going to pick up a guitar and just play whatever without the fundamentals. And every time I play, I'm relying on those fundamentals. And you talk to the most professional musician, every time they play, they're relying on those basic scales that they learned when they were 12 years old. And I'm sure for athletes, there's a great analogy that I just don't know because I'm an athlete. And I guarantee you for the soldier, they're relying and they're remembering those times they had to jump through the tires and lift the log and all those other things that soldiers do. Like, it's those fundamentals that make them ready to perform. It's not some higher level of training. It's not some, as Christians, it's not some just deeper doctrine that we need to get. It's the basics. And when we can master the fundamentals, we will find ourselves excelling in the things that God has called us to do. So we're going to start right here. I want to ask you the question. I want you to ask yourself the question, the most basic of basic training tonight, am I a Christian? And I know for you, that's your name, so like, not just your name, but am I a Christian? Really, like really, really ask yourself, like really think about it. Do I believe the gospel? A Christian is not someone who goes to church. A Christian is not someone who reads their Bible. A Christian is not someone who prays. A Christian is not someone who has faith. All those things are true about a Christian, but none of those things tell you what a Christian is. A Christian is someone who has been saved by Jesus. That's it. Am I a Christian? Have I been saved by Jesus? Do I believe the gospel? Here's the bedrock statement of the gospel in a nutshell. You can write this down on your notes. Jesus saves sinners who cannot save themselves. Jesus saves sinners who cannot save themselves. I'm going to say it three or four more times so you can write it in. Jesus saves sinners who cannot save themselves. Jesus saves sinners who cannot save themselves. Jesus saves sinners who cannot save themselves. This is what it means to be a Christian. You believe this statement is true. This is the gospel message. And until you fully accept this fact, you are not a Christian. Until you fully believe this fact, you are not a Christian. And I think this story from Luke 15 illustrates the principle of the gospel. It illustrates this concept, this idea, as well as just about any other story in the Bible. We have this son. And this son is, like, he's portrayed as a really not great kid. Like, if you want to, like, give the traits that make a bad kid in an ancient Near East culture, you're going to list this kid. He has no respect for his father in a world where respect for your elders means everything. This is a culture based around honor. And so, like, if you want to climb high in society, you honor those above you, and you yourself become an honored person. And this son immediately comes to his father. The story starts with this. He goes straight to his father. The younger son tells his father, I want my share of your estate now before you die. Think about that. When are you supposed to get your inheritance? Before the person dies or after the person dies? After the person dies. So what does he do? He goes to his father and says, Dad, you're dead to me. That's what he does. He says, I want my inheritance now. I wish you were dead. I wish you were no longer a part of my life. I wish you didn't exist. That's what this kid does. Like, this is not a lovable, cute little dude. Like, this is like, this guy's a jerk. He goes to dad and says, F you, dad. I want you gone. I'm out. I'm done with you. Bye. Give me my money. I'm leaving. This is what he does. This is not this nice kid. Not only that, he takes the money, he leaves town, totally disrespecting his family, and then he blows his money. What does he blow it on? Like, the Bible doesn't go into explicit detail here, but I can tell you what he blows it on. Hookers and blow. That's what he blows it on. He goes for drugs, he goes for sex, he goes for gambling. He just wastes it away. He says, how can I have the most fun in the shortest time and for the most money possible? That's what I'm going to do. This is not a good kid. This is not the kind of dude you'd be like, that's the kind of guy that I want to be. This is the guy, when he comes to share his testimony, you're like, ooh, I don't think you can say that word in church, bro. That's the kind of guy that this is. And what we need to do, if we believe the gospel, we need to understand, I am this person. I am a sinner. You can write that down. I am a sinner. This is, if you want a shining portrait of a sinner, this is a sinner right here, this kid. And you need to identify yourself with this person. You need to look yourself in the mirror and say, this is who I am in relation to God. You might think you're a much better person than him, but that's simply not true. This is what all of us have done to God. Every time we sin, every time we ignore God's call and voice, every time we ignore conviction, we are looking God in the face and saying, you are dead to me, Dad. Screw you. Get out of my life. I don't care. That's where we're at apart from Jesus. That's the state that we are born into. We need to understand that we're the sort of people who need saving. Now, we don't like this, right? As modern Western Christians, we want to think that, no, I don't need saving. I don't need salvation. I can save myself. I'll pay off my debt. I'll work really hard. No. You are someone in this state of, like, reproach. You are someone in this, like, you're not a nice guy. You might think you're nice. You're not. What did Tony Simon say at camp last year? You're worse than you think you are. Something like that. You're worse than you think you are. However bad you think you are worse. Amen. God bless you. Go home. But we need to come to grips. And until we recognize the depths of our sin, we will not understand the beauty of the gospel. The idea that Jesus saves sinners will not resonate with us. You will not recognize how much God loves you until you realize how much you needed love. You will not realize how much God has saved you from until you realize how much you needed saving from. You are, I am. I'm putting this in I am statements because I want us to, like, we could say this to ourselves about ourselves. This is what we need to confess and believe. If we're a Christian, we would say these things about ourselves. I would say, I am a sinner. I am someone who needs saving. I am inherently wicked. I am not a good person. There is not a good fiber in my body. Everything within me wants to rebel against God. Every bone in my body is bent away from following Jesus and bent towards satisfying my own desire, living for myself. This is who I am. This is true. The second thing we need to recognize, I cannot save myself. I cannot save myself. And in a modern Western culture, this is the hardest thing to get people to believe. It is not that hard to get people to realize that they're bad. Like, it's pretty obvious. Like, we see people and we see ourselves, and most of us on a good day can be pretty honest with ourselves. We can look in the mirror and we can see ourselves pretty truthfully. And on a good day, you can see that, yeah, you're not a great person. I'm not a great person. I got some places to grow. But then where our culture pushes us to say is, but that's okay because God should love me anyway. And last week, we spent a while talking about why that's not true. And so if you missed last week, you have to go back and watch it because I don't have time to re-unpack that. Or we might say, yeah, I'm a wicked, terrible person, but I'll make up for it. And this is kind of the world we live in. And I think this is what a lot of you are told by just the culture around you. You know you're not right. You know there's something wrong with you. But if you do good enough, if you try hard enough, if you make enough money, if you do enough nice things, if you donate enough money to charitable organizations, you can make up for your sin. I just watched the Godfather movies this last weekend. A really enjoyable trilogy. I can't recommend it, but I had a lot of fun watching them. And it's the story of this mafia boss who amasses all this power, does all these really terrible, wicked things in order to get to his power. He gets the end of his life, and he's trying to make up for all his past sins. And so he donates millions and millions of dollars to the church. He builds hospitals. He does all these good things. And yet, none of them can make him feel any better about himself. He still feels his wickedness and his guiltiness on the inside. And this is true about all of us. No matter how many good things you do, you won't be able to make up for the bad in your life. It's just not going to happen. You cannot earn your salvation by doing good things. And a Christian believes this is true. A Christian believes I cannot save myself. I am incapable of affecting my own salvation. It is impossible for me to do enough, to try hard enough to make up for all the bad that I've done. The other thing this means is I can't atone for my wickedness. I can't make up for the bad things that I've done by suffering. I can't pay the price for my sins by experiencing bad things. This is like the martyr complex. This is like the other side of the coin. Like, on one side, we have the people who say, well, I'm going to work really hard. I'm going to do a lot of good things, and that will make up for how bad of a person I am. I did this bad thing, so I'm going to do a good thing to balance it out. And we have other people who say, I did bad things. I'm a bad person, and so I need to suffer a lot of pain in order to make up for it. This is the other way you can go. You can say, well, I just need to, and so people punish themselves. And this happens a lot of times, actually, with addicts and with people experiencing homelessness, with people experiencing these issues. They've looked at how messed up they are, and a lot of them, they'll look at it and they'll say, I deserve this. I deserve the way that I'm living. And so they won't seek help because they feel like, well, I deserve to be where I am, and so I'm not going to try to get any better because I've earned this lot in life. And it almost becomes, it's like, if I suffer enough, then I'll make up for it. And so they pray these prayers like, God, just keep punishing me so that I'll make up for all the bad. God, have I been hurt enough? Have I suffered enough? And we can get into this spot in our lives, in our relationships with other people even, or in the way we live, where we see our badness, we see the bad things, and we say, well, if I can just lose more friendships, if I can feel enough like guiltiness, then I will make up for it. I just need to really feel how guilty I am. I need to experience a lot of bad things. I don't deserve good things to happen to me. I deserve bad things to happen to me. And in this twisted way, we think that by experiencing these bad things, it will make up for what a bad person that we are. And so we walk around life waiting for the other shoe to drop. Every time something good happens, we're waiting for God to smack us from heaven with a lightning bolt because we know that we don't deserve the good in life. And so we're waiting for God to just get us with his flip-flop and his chancla. And we're waiting for it. And neither of these things, neither the good you do nor the ill that you suffer, neither of these things can make up for your wickedness. We see this illustrated here in this son. Because this son, he has this conversion moment. In verse 17, he comes to his senses. I love that word. He, in verse 17, when he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "At home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare, and here I am dying of hunger." He looks at his life and he says, "Man, this ain't it. This life that I'm living right now, this is not, there's got to be more to this life. There's got to be something better for me." And my prayer and my hope for you is that tonight you would come to your senses, that you would look at the life you're living and you say, there has to be something more. There has to be something greater. There has to be something better for me than the life that I'm in right now. There's got to be more. This is this recognition, right? I'm a sinner. There's something wrong. There's something broken. And then we see him make this second jump in verse 18 and 19. Look at it with me. He says, "I will go home to my father and say," notice he states it straight up, "Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son." He has this moment of realization and confession of, "I cannot save myself. I am a sinner. I am not worthy of being called a son. I've sinned against heaven and against my Father, both against God and against my fellow humans, and I am a wretch and I need help." And this is the moment a true Christian has come to this moment. If you have not reached this point in your life, you are not a Christian. If you've never had this moment of recognition, "I have sinned, I owe a great debt, I am wretched, there is something wrong with me, and I need someone to save me." If that moment has not happened for you, you are not a Christian. And so I invite you tonight, come to your senses. Recognize this is you. This is the truth. But it doesn't stop there. And I love that this story keeps going. Look at what he says in verse 11. To illustrate the point further, Jesus told them this story. That's how this story begins. This story has a point. What's the point? Well, if we read back to verse, If we read back to verse 1 and 2. Here's the context of this story. Here's what's going on. Here's why Jesus tells the story in the first place. Luke chapter 15, verse 1. Tax collectors and other notorious sinners often came to listen to Jesus teach. This made the Pharisees and teachers of religious law complain that he was associating with such sinful people, even eating with them. So Jesus told this story. And we get to verse 11. To illustrate the point further, Jesus told them this story. Jesus has told these different stories, these religious teachers who see that Jesus hangs out with the sinners. Jesus hangs out with the losers. Jesus hangs out with the prodigal sons. They don't like this. And Jesus says, "Hey, look, I know you don't like this, but I want to show you what I'm like. I want to show you who I really am." So he tells these stories to illustrate his character. You can write this down. I can be saved by the grace of God through the cross. I can be saved by the grace of God through the cross. I can be saved by the grace of God through the cross. Jesus is not the person who doesn't associate himself with sinners. Jesus is not the person who looks at you in your sin and your wickedness and says, "Ugh, no, that's too much drama for me to deal with." Jesus is not like that. Jesus sees you in your sin. Jesus sees you in your brokenness. Jesus sees you in the midst and depths of depravity and grossness and nastiness. And he says, "That's right where I want to be. These are the kind of people that I want to hang out. This is the kind of person that I want to save." Jesus only saves people who cannot save themselves. Jesus saves sinners who cannot save themselves. If you are a good enough person, Jesus wants nothing to do with you. If you are someone who can make it on your own, Jesus is not interested in you. If you are someone who's come to recognize, "I have sinned against heaven, I've sinned against God," you are the kind of person that Jesus saves. You are the kind of person that Jesus is interested in spending time with. You are the kind of person that Jesus loves. He has no interest in the religious folk who think they're good enough. He doesn't care about them, won't even give them the time of day. All he wants to do is spend time with us. What does it say here? The tax collectors and other notorious sinners. That word notorious means like the worst of the worst, famously evil, like wicked beyond belief. And these are the kinds of people that Jesus says, that's who I want to be with. I came for the lost ones. I came for the lost things. He tells these three different stories here in Luke 15. He talks about the lost coin, the lost sheep. You've heard about the lost sheep before, right? Sheep, there's 100 sheep, and the shepherd sees that one has fallen off a cliff, and so he leaves the 99 sheep who are okay. He goes after the one lost sheep who fell off the cliff. He picks the sheep back up. He bandages its wounds. He brings it back into the pack. This is who Jesus is interested in. The lost coin, the lost sheep, the lost son, lost people, lost things. So if you're hearing tonight and you're saying, man, I'm a lost person. I am lost. I don't know where I'm going in life. I don't know what I want to do with my life. I don't know how I ended up where I am, but I know that I'm not where I need to be. I am lost. You are the kind of person that Jesus came for. He came for lost people. And so a Christian believes I am a sinner. A Christian believes I cannot save myself. A Christian believes I can be saved by the grace of God through the cross. The death and resurrection of Jesus can save me. This son goes home. And we get an illustration of the love of God for sinners. We get a picture of the love that God has, the grace that God has for lost people. Verse 20, he returned home to his father, and while he was still a long way off, the father saw him coming. How did the father see him coming? He wasn't sitting inside the house cursing his son. He was sitting out on the porch. He was standing at the edge of the road, at the edge of the driveway, looking, scanning the road, waiting for his son to return to him. And when he saw him from a long way off, what does he do? He's filled with love and compassion. There's no shame there. There's no anger. There's no wrath. There's no like, oh, you owe me. I'm going to go get what I'm owed. I'm going to go beat that boy. No, filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. This is the love of the Father for sinners. This is how God looks at you as a sinner. Not with disgust, not with embarrassment, but with love and compassion. No one is too far gone. No one is so far down the road that the Father can't save them, that the Father wouldn't love them, that the Father wouldn't be looking for them. You are not too far gone. In fact, I encourage you, write that down. I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. I can be saved by the grace of God through the cross. I am not too far gone. It's not too late for you. God is the God who saves. Look at this. Who makes the first move? The Father runs towards the Son. The Father comes to the Son. The Father comes with forgiveness. The Father comes with love. In the same way, God is the one who saves. He sends his Son. He brings us to faith through the Holy Spirit. He initiates the process of salvation. He looks at a whole bunch of wicked sons, and before that son ever returned, the Father was out waiting and watching. The Father was already going and looking for his Son. And in the same way, the Father, God the Father, has already gone out looking and seeking for sinners who might be saved. He's already sent his Son to die on a cross. He's already sent Jesus to pay the price for your sin. And now he's watching, he's looking, he's waiting, he's scanning the horizon, waiting for you to come home, waiting for you to accept his invitation, waiting for you to return, waiting for you to come to where you've always meant to be. So come back to the Father. A Christian believes that Jesus died my death and lived my life. The price was already paid. This is why the Father can be filled with love and compassion, because someone's already paid the debt that he was owed. Someone's already taken his vengeance and his wrath. So he doesn't have any of that for his son. The Father God has no wrath or vengeance or anger towards you as a sinner. He's already dealt with that through the cross. Jesus has died your death. Jesus was punished so you don't have to be. He's taking care of it. And so now all that God feels towards you is love. He's inviting you to come. And it's when you believe these things that you are a Christian. When you come to the realization that I'm a sinner, that I cannot save myself, but I can be saved, not through my own effort, not through my own work, but by the grace of God through the cross of Jesus, the death and resurrection of Jesus. That is when you become a Christian. And so we're going to end tonight a little bit differently. We're not going to break into small groups. As I was praying this morning, I sensed the Lord kind of leading me a different direction. And I want to give us just an opportunity to respond. And so I'm going to have them turn on like some soft music in the background so there's not like awkward silence. And I just want to give us a chance to respond to God's call tonight. Because I believe that the Father is calling. The Father is standing at the edge of the road. He's looking. He's looking for sinners to come home. And so the invitation stands here. Will you come? Will you receive? Will you be a part of God's family? Will you become for the very first time a Christian? Now I don't want you to get this wrong. If you're someone who's already come to God in forgiveness, that's it. Like that. It's taken care of. That's already happened. You don't need to recommit. You don't need to rededicate. You don't need to pray the prayer again and get saved all over again. You can't lose your salvation. You can't, like, the Bible's really clear, right? It says that we're held within the hand of God, and we can't jump out. We can't escape. We can't be plucked out. But if you've never come to Jesus before in recognition of your sin, if you've never like had this honest self-evaluation and said, I don't think I'm a Christian, then tonight is the night to come. And so what we're going to do, I'm going to ask us, we're going to close our eyes, we're going to pray, I'm going to lead you in a little bit of prayer. But if you need to pray with like a person, sometimes I know it's like I want to talk with someone, I want to pray with someone. Our youth leaders they're in the back of the room, and you can go pray with one of them. Just head to the back. You don't need to wait for me to dismiss you. This is your dismissal now. If you need to pray with someone, you need to respond by talking to someone. Maybe you feel some guilt, you need to talk through it. You have some questions, you need to talk through them. Youth leaders in the back, you can go at any point in time and talk with him. For the rest of us, I want to just lead you in some short prayer. So close your eyes. Like, let's eliminate the distractions right now. This is a moment where we get between you and Jesus and nothing else. So now all the eyes are closed. And again, if you're like, I didn't want someone to see me getting up, but like now everyone's eyes are closed, so I'm going to do that now. You can go. The invitation's there. We're just going to give a moment for the Holy Spirit to speak and work. We're going to spend some time in prayer together. God, I thank you for this story. That this is more than just some fairy tale. This is more than just a story. This story means something. This story is meant to do something in us. Lord, I pray that in this moment, your word would do its work in our hearts. Would you convict us of sin? Would we see ourselves truly, honestly, apart from any mask, apart from any baggage, apart from anyone else's opinions or ideas or what culture around us says? Lord, would we see just how sinful we are and how much we need you? Lord, would you convict us? Would you show us areas in our lives where we are trying to save ourselves? Whether that's through performance, through achievement, whether that's through some amount of suffering, whether that's through just like relationships with other people and trying to be this really good person and put on a good front. Whether that's even through making lots of money and climbing the social ladder, climbing the economic ladder. The truth is, all of us have an area in our life where we are trying to save ourselves. None of us are immune from this. None of us have reached some point of perfection where we are fully reliant on Jesus. And so I want to invite you right now, ask the Lord to show you, where am I relying on my own efforts? Where am I relying on my own strength? and invite him to reveal that right now in your mind and your heart. The way this will work, it'll be like maybe a phrase or a word or an image just popping into your mind. It might be just some, like, you just know it, like in like the pit of your, like the pit of your stomach, the depths of your heart, you just know, like, this is the thing. For some of us, it may involve a little bit of searching. It may be like just examining different areas. Is this it? Is it my friendships? Is it my athletic performance? Is it my grades? Is it my good behavior at home? Is it the good impression that I make for other people? Realistically, it's probably more than just one thing. It's probably a combination of all sorts of stuff. And now let's have a conversation with God about that thing, that way we're leaning on our own strength. Conversation could go something like this. God, I see this thing, and I recognize now that I'm looking at it as a way to save myself. I'm looking at my good behavior. I'm looking at, and you'll just have to fill in this blank with whatever it is, but I'm looking at the way that I live and thinking that if I just do a good enough job, I will somehow make up for all my evil things. And I see now that that isn't true. God, help me to believe the truth. Help me to believe that it's Jesus who saves me. It's not my own efforts. It's not my own good behavior. It's not suffering that I can go through. It's just you. Now let's together reflect on just the incredible nature of the cross. A place where a perfect God would give his son. A place where God himself would take our sin on himself. Think about it this way. I think about it like he's crawling down in the pig slop with us. He's eating from the pig pods that we wanted to eat from. And he's giving us a boost up over the fence, getting us out of the pig pen, bringing us into life. Picture God searching for you at the end of a road. Picture yourself running towards him and him running even faster towards you. This is the love of your God for you. And let's have another conversation with God. God, help me to believe that this is true about me. Help me to believe that I am saved by your cross. I am loved by you. That no amount of sin can ever separate me from your love. No amount of wickedness can keep you from loving me. You've dealt with all of that through your cross. You've dealt with all of that through Jesus. Help me to receive this love. Help me to accept this love. Would I be known? Would I know myself as someone loved by God? And as we're in the presence of God, just throw your cares, throw your concerns, throw your anxieties onto him. Whether that's stuff going on at school, going on at home, going on in your own mind, stuff you're going through with your friends, just put that on him. Tell him about it. Let's never waste an opportunity in God's presence to be with him. Now see him taking those things, ask him, give me your peace in place of my fear. God, give me your joy in place of my sadness. Give me protection in place of my pain and vulnerability. Give me grace in place of my sin. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you just for this time we've had together in your presence. This time we've had to confess sin to you, to bring ourselves more fully into the light. Lord, I thank you for your grace that cleanses us from all unrighteousness, your love that purifies us from all sin. Lord, may we walk out of this room tonight with heads held high, knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt, we are Christians. We are saved by the blood of Jesus. We are loved by you more than we could ever imagine. You have huge plans for our lives, and there's a place for us in this world. There's something you have for us to do. Lord, would we cling to this basic training moment? Would it be a bedrock of how we live our lives? In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Man. That was good. I don't know about you. That was good for me. That was good for me. Well, there's no better way to end it than by saying, Jesus, you are better than anything in this world. Love you guys. Have a great night. If you still need to pray with someone, talk with someone, we are still, myself included, happy to do that. I'm happy to, if you have questions or stuff you were confused on, I'm happy to clarify as well. Love you guys. Have a good night.